Hey, it's me. Call me when you can.
Tell me how so so breathing no air.
Be careful, don't get no speeding tickets, because you know what time it is? It's time for Whoop on Wheels with Fast Eddie and Big G right here on Whoop FM 99.9 and WhoopFM.com out there in the World Wide Web. Everybody's watching. Be careful, y'all. Come on, strap your babies in the car and hang on, because it's Fast Eddie and Big G right here with all your racing news right here on Whoop FM.
Yeah. Fast Eddie, Big G, and the Bullet in the house tonight. Whoop on Wells 99.9 FM, WOOP, FM.com. And we're going to have an exciting show tonight, Big G.
Yes, good.
And Bullet. We've got Derek Kneeling at 6:30, should be calling in any minute now. He is the spotter for Kyle Larson. And it'll be interesting to talk to him about, I thought Kyle was going to win that race, but to come to Nobel, he went into the wall.
He has a good job.
Yeah, Morgan Shepherd at 7, Dan Elliott again at 7:30 to 8:30. He's going to have an hour. He's ready, excited. Johnny Roberts with NASCAR Race Hub at 8:30. Good lineup. Good show. We'll be ready for it, for sure.
That's right.
We're going to play a few sponsors. We'll be right back and waiting on Derek Kneeling. We'll be right back.
And now, back to Whoop on Wheels.
Whoop on Wheels.
Call 614-5553 to be a part of the show, only on Whoop Island.
Whoop, whoop.
Radio 99.
Hey, race fans, you're listening to Whoop on Wheels with Fast Eddie, Big G, and the Bullet. Tune in every Tuesday night at 6 p.m. to 9 o'clock that night for some good racing action.
Whoop on Wheels. Whoop Radio is your racing station. Tuesday nights at 7.
You got Big G, Fast Eddie, and the Bullet.
Call 614-5553.
All right, buddy.
Whoop on Wheels, your connection to NASCAR and Talladega on Whoop Island.
Whoop, whoop.
Radio 99.
This is Barry Houston with Furniture Roll Racing, hanging out with Big G and Fast Eddie and Bullet on Whoop on Wheels.
The sun is out, the kids are home, and you're ready to make this summer one they'll never forget. Gather up the family and head over to Lake Winnie, where there's excitement for everyone. The little ones will light up on attractions like the flying elephants and bumblebees. Get your hearts racing as you freefall 14 stories on the ozone and see if you can stomach the all-new Twister ride. Then satisfy your taste buds with delicious treats like the legendary funnel cakes. With so much to offer and so close to home, Lake Winnie is the perfect place for every family to have fun together. Open Thursday through Sunday and Monday Memorial Day. Sokia Water Park opens Saturday, May 28th. Don't miss the music of the Band Organ Organization of America, May 28th, 29th, and 30th. So come on over to Lake Winnie and make today a special one. For more information, visit lakewinnie.com.
Whoop on Wheels is proud to be sponsored by the Gondolier for all your Italian and Greek specialties, as well as the best pizza in town. Gondolier locations are at Okoy, 1603 Highway 64, Benton, Tennessee. That phone number, 338-7299. Stop in and see the fine folks at the Okoy Gondolier. And if you're in the Cleveland area, they're located at 3300 Keith Street, 472-4998. All items at Gondolier can be fixed for you to take home. Proud sponsors of Whoop on Wheels and the Gondolier. For all your pet grooming needs, see the staff at Happy Tails Grooming Salon. Happy Tails, located at 2251 North Okoy Street. Business hours are Tuesday through Friday, 8 to 5:30, Saturday, 9 to 5:30. For your appointment, call 339-5777. A full-service professional groomer. Happy Tails Grooming Salon. Come shaggy, leave happy. Are you looking for a new salon or stylist? Well, let me give you a little heads up. Heads Up Hair Design, that is. Heads Up Hair Design, located at 60 Mouse Creek Road. Call Carmen Wilson at 476-5722 for your appointment. And as always, walk-ins are welcome. Stop in and see the good folks at Heads Up Hair Design. Welcome to L&B Appliance Sales, 160 Durkee Road Northeast in Cleveland, Tennessee. 339-3231 is that phone number, owned and operated by Jason Taylor. Why choose L&B Appliance Sales? Great prices on top brands, the best selection of appliances and home furnishings, friendly, helpful, and knowledgeable salespeople, professional installation and service. L&B Appliance Sales carries a large selection of appliances and home furnishings, including refrigerators, cooktops, ovens, ranges, washers, and dryers. If you are looking for appliances or home furnishings in the area, be sure to shop at L&B Appliance Sales. And before you go to their showroom, be sure to check out L&B Appliance Sales special offers, discounts, rebates, and financing special on top brand merchandise like Amana, Electrolux, Frigidaire, Whirlpool, and Maytag. L&B Appliance Sales is part of the Brands Direct network of independent dealers. Brands Direct dealers offer their customers the best names in brand appliances, furniture, and electronics through the nation's single largest network of independent stores. Brands Direct have a store close to you with knowledgeable local salespeople. L&B Appliance Sales is the right choice for the discriminating shopper.
The new Hardee's Midnight Moonshine Thick Burger. It's not for everyone. It's not for you if you once tried moonshine, then call the cops on yourself. And if your idea of bootlegging is illegally taping your favorite jam band, it's not for you. But if you like the sweet burn of moonshine glaze on Black Angus beef, it's for you. The Midnight Moonshine Thick Burger. Only at Hardee's.
For a limited time, participating restaurant cooked product contains some alcohol. Midnight Moon is a registered trademark of Piedmont Distillers Incorporated, Madison, North Carolina.
The sun is out, the kids are home, and you're ready to make this summer one they'll never forget. Gather up the family and head over to Lake Winnie, the South's best value amusement park, where there's excitement for everyone. Watch the little ones light up as they experience attractions like the flying elephants and the bumblebees. Get your thrill-seeking hearts racing as you free-fall 14 stories on the Ozone and see if you can stomach the all-new Twister ride. You'll flip over it. Then, satisfy your taste buds with delicious treats like the legendary funnel cakes. With so much to offer and so close to home, Lake Winnie is the perfect place for every family to have fun together. Now open Thursday through Monday. On Thursdays, bring a canned food item and save $5 on an unlimited ride ticket. Sponsored by WRCB-TV. For more information, visit lakewinnie.com.
Hi, everybody. It's Pat Patterson, the racing guy. Don't miss this week's Whoop on Wheels. WOOP-FM 99.9, Fast Eddie, Big G, and Bullet got all your racing news. I'm Pat Patterson. Don't miss it this week.
When you're in the mood for frozen yogurt, come to Cleveland's Original, Perkins, 3506 Keith Street Northwest, located in the same plaza as Gondolier. Perkins Yogurt. Come see Roger Turpin at Perkins, 476-1668. Perkins Yogurt. Often imitated, never duplicated.
Hey kids, with Pizza Hut's $5 flavor menu, we get any two or more of our favorites for just $5 each.
So like medium one-topping pizzas for $5?
Yes.
What about two pizzas and wing street wings?
Yes.
Two pizzas, wings, breadsticks, and a cookie?
Yes.
Okay, no pizzas, 12 Hershey's cookies, still $5 each?
Yes.
Can I join the circus?
Yes. What? No, just eat your pizza.
Feels good to say yes to your Pizza Hut favorites for just $5 each. The $5 flavor menu, only at Pizza Hut.
Limited time offer, additional charge for extra cheese, toppings, and pan crust. Hershey's trademark, used under license.
When Fast Eddie and Big G want to take in a little dirt track racing, it's a good bet they're going to stop in at Quick Burger on South Lee Highway. Quick Burger, Monday through Saturday, 10:30 to 6. Call-in orders are always welcome. That phone number is 472-0463. Stop in and see Ramel Daffron and her crew, Brenda, Rob, Ryan, Ashley, Dawn, and Betty, for the best burger in town. An extensive menu, plate specials, chicken sandwiches, and the best hot dog as well. Check in with Quick Burger on South Lee Highway. When Big G and Fast Eddie need to make a pit stop for lunch, they head to Quiznos. Stop in and see Roger Patel and his crew at Quiznos Sub, 2151 Keith Street. Phone number 473-7976. For all your box lunches and catering needs, stop in and see the folks at Quiznos Sub. Quiznos. Toasty.
Hi, everybody. It's Pat Patterson, the racing guy. If you love your NASCAR, you got to love Whoop on Wheels. Tune in this week, 99.9 FM. Be sure to catch Fast Eddie, Big G, and Bullet. They got it all right there for you.
The sun is out, the kids are home, and you're ready to make this summer one they'll never forget. Gather up the family and head over to Lake Winnie, the South's best value amusement park, where there's excitement for everyone. Watch the little ones light up as they experience attractions like the flying elephants and the bumblebees. Get your thrill-seeking hearts racing as you free-fall 14 stories on the Ozone and see if you can stomach the all-new Twister ride. You'll flip over it. Then, satisfy your taste buds with delicious treats like the legendary funnel cakes. With so much to offer and so close to home, Lake Winnie is the perfect place for every family to have fun together. Now open Thursday through Monday. Every Friday, buy one unlimited ride ticket and receive another for half off with a Dr. Pepper or any Coca-Cola can. For more information, visit lakewinnie.com.
When the Whoop on Wheels crew gets back from a long weekend spent in the infield in Talladega, their first stop in town is Surf's Up Car Wash. Surf's Up, 2575 Guthrie Street Northwest, located next to Cleveland Utilities, 790-5793. Surf's Up Car Wash, voted Cleveland's best 3 years in a row. Stop by and see Mike Royville and his gang at Surf's Up.
The sun is out, the kids are home, and you're ready to make this summer one they'll never forget. Gather up the family and head over to Lake Winnie, the South's best value amusement park, where there's excitement for everyone. Watch the little ones light up as they experience attractions like the flying elephants and the bumblebees. Get your thrill-seeking hearts racing as you free-fall 14 stories on the Ozone and see if you can stomach the all-new Twister ride. You'll flip over it. Then, satisfy your taste buds with delicious treats like the legendary funnel cakes. With so much to offer and so close to home, Lake Winnie is the perfect place for every family to have fun together. Now open Thursday through Monday. Save $3 every day but Saturday with a coupon from Sunbeam Bread. For more information and to discover all the fun-filled attractions Lake Winnie has to offer, visit lakewinnie.com.
Welcome to the Island of Whoop
at 99.9 FM.
Your hometown oasis. Whoop FM.
Whoop, whoop.
Radio 99.
Hey, we got a phone call here. It's Derek, I think. Hey, Derek, how you doing, my friend?
Hey, what's going on, guys?
Doing good. Doing good. You got Fast Eddie and Bullet in here right now. I don't know what happened to Big G.
I think he said he had to go to the bathroom real quick.
Well, okay.
Yeah, I'll take a little bathroom break.
Yeah. How you been doing, Derek?
I'm good, man. I can't complain. You know, we were down at the All-Star race last week, and now I got to fly home for a few days to hang out with the family. Took the fiance out to dinner right now. Thankfully, she's got a plate of food in front of her face, so I was able to get away for a couple minutes to talk to you guys and, you know, like I said, hang out for a couple of days and got to head back to the 600 and get back to work.
Yeah. We won't keep you long here, but I just wanted to talk with you. What did you think about the All-Star race?
First off, you know, we didn't even know if we were going to be in the All-Star race. We didn't have, I know we were top five in the fan vote, so we really weren't banking on that. We had to try to race our way in. You know, this year they had it to where it was three segments, and you take the winner from each segment. And thankfully, we had to put on one heck of a show on that last part of the segment there to beat Chase Elliott on, you know, his four tires. We were only on two tires, so, we did what we had to do to hold him off and make it in. And once we made it in, the guys did a great job preparing the car for the All-Star race, and we did nothing but just start, being really, really fast right from the drop of the green. And Kyle didn't waste any time. We got all the way up to ninth, I think, in the first segment. And then we won the second segment, and we took the lead on lap one of the last segment and was in cruise control, so to speak. And we just got a little too free within those last five laps, and Logano was able to run us down and get by us. But Kyle did a great job. The team did a great job. It was our first All-Star race, and to be able to even lead it is just really exciting.
Yeah, I was hoping that Kyle would have won that thing, and he was on his way there. What was he, about three laps short after he hit that?
We just got the two to go. We went into turn one, and we hit the wall. So we were two laps shy from taking $1 million home.
Woo, doggy. I bet you Kyle was going to split that with you, wasn't he, Derek? Some of it.
I hope so, but I don't know. We never even talked about it. I didn't honestly think that we were going to have that much a chance at it with having to, go by points, you know, and have to start towards the back. I didn't think we were really going to have that much of a chance with as quick as the segments were, but, man, that car was really quick. Hopefully we're bringing a car back just as similar to that, and I think we're going to have a really good shot in the 600.
Yeah, that'd be good, that's for sure. I bet you Joey Logano took that suitcase of money and run.
Probably. I mean, he did a great job. Me and my fiance were actually just talking about it, before I called you guys. It was, Joey's he's a hard racer. A lot of people like him. A lot of people don't like him, with the whole Kansas deal. But, I don't really have an opinion on him, but I can't say anything but, good things right now about it. Because, I mean, when he got to us, he could have done, worse to us to be able to get by, and get it roughed us up. I mean, he raced us clean and, was good hard racing for that first lap until we got too loose trying to run down on his door to slow him down, and we got loose and hit the wall. So, I mean, it was really cool coming two laps to go and being able to race it, race somebody hard for it and, not get wrecked by the guy intentionally trying to win it. So that was really cool.
Well, Derek, like we was talking on the telephone there before we come on the air, I'm proud of you guys, and you guys done real good and done great. And we hope you have a good car come to 600, and, all you can do is just get out there and win it.
Yeah, I mean, I haven't changed anything that I've done the last, this is my fourth year now with Chip Ganassi Racing, and, I just thankful for the opportunity that I've got with these guys, and glad I get to work with such a great driver with Kyle, and it all goes to, like I said, I haven't changed anything that I've been doing. I've just been doing everything that Kyle likes and likes to hear, and anything I can do to help the crew chief that I'm seeing and stuff like that on our second channel, and it just all goes to the team. I mean, they've just done such a phenomenal job on really stepping up our program. I think we were all kind of expecting big things, and we start off the year, Daytona is a crapshoot and Talladega is a crapshoot, so you really can't take that into consideration. But we started the season kind of on a really bad foot, and the guys have worked really, really hard, and we've had nothing but really good runs the last 4 weeks. Talladega, we get up to the lead, we lead 12 laps, and we get wrecked running in the top 10, and then, we go to Kansas, we're on second, three wide, and we get wrecked by Brad Keselowski and Denny Hamlin, who are already in the chase. And, then you go to Dover last week, and, I give, Kyle praise for that. He was trying to race them clean and, or race Kansas clean and trying to, earn that first win, the right way. So that way, he can have that as comfort in his mind. But, hopefully we'll get a win here, but within the next, I don't know, what is it, 17 or 18 races that we got until the chase starts. If not, then I'm sure he wish he moved him. But I think we keep running like we have been the last 4 weeks. I think our wins are coming sooner than later, and I can't think of any better place to start winning than the Coke 600. So hopefully this will be our time.
Yeah, I think it if it had been another driver, I guess an older or a driver, I ain't gonna say older driver, I'm not gonna say there any drivers out there is old, but any other drivers had any experience, I believe would have moved Kansas out of the way, and not thought, anything about it.
Yeah, I totally agree, but I mean, like I said, Kyle hasn't gotten an actual, cup win yet. He's really hungry, but, I applaud him for, what he did, because, I mean, don't get me wrong, I want to be in the chase just as bad as anybody else, but, when it comes down to it, I stand behind my, my driver 110%, and he's trying to do it the right way. And, he earned, Kansas respect on it, and not just his. I mean, it's going to go back to a lot of those, like you said, older drivers or veteran drivers that, saw how he raced Kansas. And, I think they're going to probably race him with a little bit more, respect too. And if they don't, then they might get the same back. But I think for the most aspect, everybody saw how clean Kyle races for the most part, and how bad he wants it, and how much he's gonna he's gonna do right by people to get the wins correctly and not having to wreck people to do it.
Yeah, I agree with you. It's like I don't remember if it's Dover or might have been up in Kansas Carl Edwards, he got wrecked, and I can't remember who wrecked him. I've been Casey Kane, one thought that got into him. Casey didn't know if he got into him or not, and you know, in case he radioed to his spotter or to his crew chief or something, said, you know, if I did anything wrong, tell Carl I'm sorry, I didn't mean to do it. And
you know, that was actually us at Dover.
Was at Dover.
Yeah.
You know, and I thought that was pretty good for him to say that. And then, you know, Carl come back around saying, you know, that makes me feel better that he said something about it.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, like I said, Kyle doesn't, you know, if you look back at all the races, you know, he races hard. And, you know, if he makes anybody mad, it's just because he's racing hard. He hasn't raced him to where he's, you know, wrecked many people. So, you know, I think once Carl looked back and he saw the replays and the tapes and stuff like that, you know, that's why he came back and said, you know, I'm sorry for the, you know, first bit of information I had to say, you know, on interviews, because, you know, after looking back at it, you know, Kyle didn't do anything wrong. He was racing hard and,
yeah.
You know, just mistakes were made. So, you know, everything was good. I mean, Carl was right behind us. We raced around each other almost all night at the All-Star race, and everything was fine. So, I mean, I think they got a lot of respect for each other, and, you know, they'll be fine moving forward.
Yeah, I think you're right on that. It's, you know, Kyle is a good little racer, and, you know, I've seen, well, I haven't never got to talk to him at the racetrack. We've seen him several times, and, you know, me and Fast Eddie, we're not little bitty fellers, but we're not big guys either. But, I mean, we're not monsters, but to him, we're monsters.
Right.
You know, 6 foot one or two, and him being, what, 5 foot five, whatever it is.
Yeah, I think he's 5'7". I mean, me and him are about the same height, only he's a skinny little guy, you know?
Yeah, little bitty fella, ain't he?
Yeah, he's just a little guy. Heck out of that car.
Hey, Derek, I'm going to send the PR. Do you know who the PR person is for Kyle? I'm going to try to get him on the show.
Yeah, his name is Davis Schaefer.
Yeah, I'll try to.
David Schaefer?
Davis.
Davis.
I'll try to get a hold of them. I'd like to get him on this show somehow. I just got to sit down. I've got my PR sheets. And I'm going to try to get him on here somehow. I've never had him on. He's never been on the Whoop on Wheel Show.
I'll pull for that, but.
Yeah. It may be tough, but we're going to give it a shot.
To talk to.
All right.
Yeah, we'd love to have him on here.
Hello, Dirk. This is Bullet. I just want to say that I've got a little segment that comes on. And here about 2 weeks ago, I actually voted Kyle Larson as my driver of the week.
Well, hell, he's been the driver of the last 3 weeks, as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, well, he has. But I just went over. I watched that race. I think he's won about 2 weeks ago. That he was. I think he's doing a great job.
Yeah, no, he's doing great. And like I said, it all goes back to, you know, our team. You know, like I said, we started the season on not a very good foot at all, and you know the guys worked really really hard, and you know, given something that Kyle can work with, and they've done a great job. I mean, if we don't win soon, I'll be very surprised. I mean, they're working hard. Kyle's driving his butt off. He believes in them. They believe in him. And, you know, we just got something good going right now. We just need to keep working with that.
Also, I was bragging on you, too. Just before you called in, I was telling Fast Eddie, I said, you have an important job. And I wish I could be a spotter.
Well, I mean, I've been lucky enough to fall into the right job. You know, I mean, I grew up racing my whole life. And, you know, finally I was right place at the right time and got a good opportunity, you know, years ago now. But, you know, just really thankful. Me and Kyle got a great friendship, relationship now. So, you know, hopefully I'll be with him for at least, I don't know, I'd like to say I got at least 20 more years in me and then I'd be good on retiring. So hopefully he's on the same board as me and we'll keep rolling.
That's right. Well, Derek, we're going to let you go here. We didn't want to keep you too long since you got dinner waiting and everything, but I really appreciate you coming back on the show this quick of a notice and stuff, and we will get you back on later on in the season.
Yeah, no problem. Hopefully, you know, once we get that first win, you guys will be the first show that we're on to talk about that win.
You can better bet on it. I'll be after you.
Appreciate everything. Thanks so much.
All right. Thank you.
All right, see you.
All right, guys. Have a good night.
Mm-hmm. Bye-bye. Derek Neeling, spotter for number 42, Kyle Larson.
Yep.
And Kyle almost won that thing. It was hot.
You know, I've never asked them guys what they might not want to say. I wonder how much they get paid for doing that, spotter. Probably good.
I don't know. They got to have an eye, a good eye.
Got to have a good eye. Can't have bad ones like me.
Use them binoculars.
No. Yeah.
That's for sure. All right, Bullet, let's take it over to you for the Bullet Air.
Okay, we'll start off with the Camping World Truck Series. The standings now, Matt Crafton won the race, and Kyle Busch coming second. Johnny Salter was third. Tyler Reddick's fourth. Fifth was Matt Tiff. And coming in sixth was Spencer Gallagher.
Gallagher.
And seventh was Timothy Peters. Eighth, Christopher Bell. Coming in ninth was Daniel Hemrick. And right out of top ten was old William Byram. He was on the show here not long ago.
Yep.
And then in the points, Matt Crafton's leading the points. Timothy Peters second. Third is Daniel Hemrick. Fourth, Spencer Gallagher. Fifth, William Byram. And coming in sixth is Ryan Truex. Seventh, John Hunter Nemechek. Eighth, Tyler Reddick. Christopher Bell was nine. And round out top ten in points, Johnny Sauter. That's your Camping World Truck Series. And the Sprint Cup, Joey Logano, of course, won that race. Brad Keselowski coming second. Dale Earnhardt Jr. was third. Carl Edwards fourth. Kyle Busch come in fifth. Chase Elliott was sixth. And Trevor Bain was seventh. Greg Biffle was eighth. And Denny Hamlin was coming ninth. And Kyle Busch come in tenth.
This was the all-star race, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I should have said. Yeah. And then the points, Kevin Harvick's leading the points. Kyle Busch is second. Kurt Busch is third. Carl Edwards is fourth. Jimmy Johnson is fifth. Brad Keselowski is sixth. Chase Elliott is seventh. Joey Logano is eighth. And Martin Truex Jr. is ninth. Austin Dillon is tenth. Dale Earnhardt Jr. is still 11th. Matt Kenseth is 12th. And Denny Hamlin is 13th. Jamie McMurray is 14th. Ryan Blaney is 15th in the points. And round out the top 16 is A.J. Allmendinger. That's your 16th, number 16 in points.
Wow.
And Odell Jr., he's still hanging in there.
Needs a win.
Yep, he just sure does.
Needs a win would help him.
Yep.
Well, we got 17 more races to go.
Surely to gosh, he'll get a win somewhere down the road here.
How many more we got?
Did you notice him saying the word retirement?
Yeah, I heard him say that. Yeah, I heard that.
He'd like to win that 600 up there in Charlotte before he retired.
That's coming.
I think that's coming.
I heard that come out of his mouth.
Yeah. And also, too, if everybody been under a rock not heard it, but Kevin Harvick did sign a four-year deal with Stuart Haas Racing. And what I like that he said, he went to Casey Kane and told Casey, he said, nobody from your organization's talked to me, has never talked to me, not to worry about it. Run your race, do what you got to do, and he said, you'll be fine.
Yeah.
And I really respect Kevin Harvick for saying that.
Yeah.
That's how them rumors get started.
Yep.
Yeah.
That's what Kevin said. He said, I don't know who started this rumor. He said, that's just the way things go.
Right.
He just didn't know.
Happens every time.
Sure does.
We got Mr. Shepherd coming up in 4 minutes, so we'll take another break. We'll be back.
Welcome to the Island of Whoop
at 99.9 FM,
your hometown oasis, Whoop FM. Whoop, and now, back to Whoop on Wheels.
Whoop on Wheels.
Call 614-5553.
Hey, race fans, you're listening to Whoop on Wheels with Fast Eddie, Big G, and The Bullet. Tune in every Tuesday night at 6 p.m. to 9 o'clock that night for some good racing action.
Whoop on Wheels.
Whoop Radio is your racing station. Tuesday nights at 7.
You got Big G, Fast Eddie, and The Bullet.
Call 614-5553.
All right, buddy.
Whoop on Wheels. Your connection to NASCAR and Talladega on Whoop Island.
Whoop, whoop.
Radio 99.
This is Barry Houston with Furniture Roll Racing, hanging out with Big G and Fast Eddie and Bullet on Whoop on Wheels.
The sun is out, the kids are home, and you're ready to make this summer one they'll never forget. Gather up the family and head over to Lake Winnie, where there's excitement for everyone. The little ones will light up on attractions like the flying elephants and bumblebees. Get your hearts racing as you freefall 14 stories on the Ozone and see if you can stomach the all-new Twister ride. Then, satisfy your taste buds with delicious treats like the legendary funnel cakes. With so much to offer and so close to home, Lake Winnie is the
perfect place for every family to have fun together. Open Thursday through Sunday and Monday Memorial Day. Sokia Water Park opens Saturday, May 28th. Don't miss the music of the Band Organ Organization of America, May 28th, 29th, and 30th. So come on over to Lake Winnie and make today a special one. For more information, visit lakewinnie.com.
Now back to Whoop on Wheels with Fast Eddie, Big G, and the Bullet.
Whoop on Wheels is proud to be sponsored by the Gondolier, where all your Italian and Greek specialties, as well as the best pizza in town. Gondolier locations are at Okoy, 1603 Highway 64, Benton, Tennessee. That phone number, 338-7299. Stop in and see the fine folks at the Okoy Gondolier. And if you're in the Cleveland area, they're located at 3300 Keith Street, 472-4998. All items at Gondolier can be fixed for you to take home. Proud sponsors of Whoop on Wheels and the Gondolier. For all your pet grooming needs, see the staff at Happy Tails Grooming Salon. Happy Tails, located at 2251 North Okoy Street. Business hours are Tuesday through Friday, 8 to 5:30, Saturday, 9 to 5:30. For your appointment, call 339-5777. A full-service professional groomer. Happy Tails Grooming Salon. Come shaggy, leave happy.
Here we go.
Now back to Whoop on Wheels with Fast Eddie, Big G, and the Bullet.
For all your pet grooming needs, see the staff at Happy Tails Grooming Salon. Happy Tails. Located at 2251 North Okoy Street. Business hours are Tuesday through Friday, 8 to 5:30, Saturday, 9 to 5:30. For your appointment, call 339-5777. A full-service professional groomer. Happy Tails Grooming Salon. Come shaggy, leave happy. Are you looking for a new salon or stylist? Well, let me give you a little heads up. Heads Up Hair Design, that is. Heads Up Hair Design, located at 60 Mouse Creek Road. Call Carmen Wilson at 476-5722 for your appointment. And as always, walk-ins are welcome. Stop in and see the good folks at Heads Up Hair Design.
Hello, Morgan. Morgan?
Hello, Fast Eddie.
How you doing?
We're working away here in the shop, trying to get this Camaro ready for Charlotte.
How long we got with you? About 10, 15 minutes?
I'll let them finish up. We're trying to get our springs worked out to where they don't coil bind or anything, and then we're going to set on the bump stop springs. We're putting quite a bit of effort into it to try to get this thing turned around. It was so bad at Dover that I got to see something better than that.
Yeah.
There's 42 cars, and so we've got to qualify better than 33rd, so I got to make the chassis go through the corners.
And Morgan can do that.
Well, I hope so. This is a whole new way of doing it. We're trying to get it more like a cup car where the thing is on the ground and just, you know, stay down on the ground, going down the straightaway, hopefully about 3/4 inch off the right front. And you got to allow some for tire flex.
Yeah. Hey, Morgan, on my Facebook page, I changed my big picture and put your car when we was down in Talladega. I've got it on it. Yeah, I've got it on there. That's racing with Jesus and the cross on the front.
Yeah, appreciate that. My deal over at West Virginia at the church really went well.
That's good.
That is good.
We had a good turnout, and everybody come by and told me they appreciated my testimony.
That's good, Morgan. That's a good deal there.
Well, that's...
It is.
The people that help us, that's what they're helping us for, to carry the word. And so that's what we're here for.
Yeah. That's for sure.
We got on the show tonight.
We're going to have old...
we got Dan Elliott back on.
Are you?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. He's eager to go.
Okay.
Yeah, he's ready to go.
He's going to be calling us about 7:25. I said, well, now, I got Morgan calls in. I mean, we'll be talking to him, and then we'll slap you on there.
Well, that's yep. good.
He's good. He's a good fella. I like old Dan.
I've got I got a little appearance to do Friday down at Charlotte from 10 until 1.
Yeah.
Hmm. Yep. Then I forgot, Dan, we got John Roberts coming on the show.
Yeah. Johnny Roberts.
Oh, well, that's good.
And Race Hub, I think he is.
Yep. Then we just got Derek Nealing.
We just got through talking to Derek Nealing.
Yep.
About
Kyle Larson's spotter.
Okay.
So you're in good company tonight.
That little Kyle Larson's been driving the wheels off that thing.
Boy, he has, hadn't he?
Yeah.
Man. Now, you said you was trying to get your car. You said you're going to try to do the bump stop after you get done what you're doing now?
Yeah, well, we've been doing them. But what I'm going to do, I've run big springs and this and that. And anyway, I was real disappointed that we were so bad at Dover. So now I'm going to work towards just soft springs in the front end and where the thing gets down on the bump stops and runs on them. That's kind of like the Cup cars. They just, they got about an 8,000 pound spring in the right front and they just, NASCAR took away the height rule for them. I wish they'd take it away for us.
Right.
We could do the same thing. But the way we're gonna work ours is we'll run soft springs, and then we'll set on the bump stop. So that's what we'll be trying to do at Charlotte, trying to get the same go fast.
There you go. Well, if you don't go fast, you don't qualify, do you?
And that's right.
What do y'all normally qualify at Charlotte?
Saturday morning.
Oh, you do?
Yeah.
Then so the trucks is already run.
Do what?
I said trucks is already run, so it's just going to be you all in the Sprint Cup, right?
Yep. I suppose.
Well, I know they run both run Friday night and rain them out, and they run Saturday.
Yeah.
Then now after Charlotte, you know where you're going after that?
Going to Pocono.
I like Pocono. Don't you like Pocono?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I qualified on the pole up there. I think it was 89 in the Cup car.
Well, don't you think that the Woods brothers are kind of turning cartwheels now since they got a Mr. Little Blaney's driving the wheels off that 21 car?
Yeah. I'm really happy for the Woods brothers. We probably done the best, you know. I mean, Dave Pearson did the best when he was with them, but then we kind of filled in the gap there and got the cars running pretty good. And they just haven't had much luck with their drivers until now. That little Blaney boy is really showing promises of them winning races.
Yeah,
getting their car back up front.
I know they think the world of you. Last year when I was down there at Talladega and talking to them, I mentioned your name, and then, man, that's all they had, just a lot of praise for you. They said, boy, we really like Morgan.
Yeah, I was, when I see Eddie, showing a thing there, when we won the race at Atlanta, the last one, that we went 105 miles on our fuel run. And when I see Eddie, I'm gonna ask him, who's the best guy that on fuel mileage?
You didn't do like Darrell Waltrip, did you?
He'll say you are. No, we what happened was we cut a tire down 8 laps before our pit stop. And so we run a few laps there, and we was really fast. Eddie says, we're 8 laps short. If you can save fuel, do it. And so our car was so good that I just, I was way out front. And so I just lined up behind a Quaker State car and drafted off of him and just made my straightaways real short. And anyway, we went 105 miles. And whenever we came in, drove in the winner's circle and then drove it down to the fuel pumps. And we still had fuel to go.
Wow. That's a big fuel cell, wasn't it?
No.
No, I'm saying you made it a big fuel cell. That's what I meant.
Yeah. No, we wasn't illegal. I just really saved a lot of fuel. Now, the way the track is now, it's harder to save fuel. But it's gotten slick. And when the track gets slick, then... you don't, you work on your handling and your straightaways start getting shorter. But when the track has a lot of grip, well, then you about run wide open all the way around and it's hard to save fuel then.
Well, you got a lot of drivers too running up high now. You know, seem like on all the tracks when that rubber gets rubbered in, they'll start moving up the track and, you know, that's a long way around. I don't see them saving fuel that way.
Yeah, you use more fuel when you run up high.
You don't really run up high, Morgan? Because it's easier, it's softer, hit the wall. that's just my joke of the night, Morgan.
Yeah, no, it's not no joke. That's a fact. That's what Richard Petty always said, and because he run high a lot. And I ran high to get more grip.
They wasn't soft walls back in, was it?
No. No, it was pretty hard. I tell you, every time I see Danica's wreck, oh, man, that little girl hit the wall hard at Daytona. She hit it hard at Talladega, but I was looking at the Daytona wreck, and dog, it was harder.
Yeah. Now, they had the softer barriers where she hit, didn't
they? No, not the first time.
I thought they had softer barriers where she hit it.
They've got them now.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, of course she hit this time, she did.
Yeah, I know they said she hit a lot of bruises on her the next day.
Shoot, I guarantee you.
That little girl, you know, her being no bearing what she is, she can wheel a car, can't she?
Yeah, she's, she really takes it everything 100%. Plus, she works out, she's very flexible, she keeps her weight down. Like I said, I don't think she weighs about 85 pounds.
No,
and that's with the suit on.
Yeah. Let me look at something here. My guy just, what was in it? 7.5. Oh, no. We need to go the other way. Wait a minute. No, the outer part was hitting. Yeah, you'll probably have to go to a 10, but you need a little bit of shim. See what that shim is over there that we took out and maybe not go the complete 10. We're trying to get our springs to where they don't hit on one side, get them more flatter.
Makes a difference, don't it, Morgan?
Yeah, well, we're doing this to where we don't want it to coil bind. And so we're having to change the helix in the bottom of the A-frame to where the spring doesn't touch on one side or other. When it goes all the way down, then it's just flat.
Who's helping you, Morgan?
Nick, he's our everything, crew chief. And
yeah. Whatever.
What is that, 2 degrees? Okay, that'll make it. eight and a half, probably. Just put it to where it's the outside. Put the thick part. Put the thick part here. Right straight across from that, and that'll take just a little bit out. Yeah. Okay, I'm back.
Well, we just enjoyed listening to you do a little crew chiefing there.
Yeah, I believe Morgan could work on a car.
I work on them all the time.
Yeah, I know it. I was just thinking myself.
Hey, Nick, he says, I believe Morgan can work on a car.
We're froze up. We still got audio. Well, that's
yeah. We had Jack in here helping us a little bit ago.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, Diesel and Jack. Jack's my billy goat.
We'll have to call him Jack the Billy Goat.
Yeah. Yeah.
Old Jack.
You're eating paper and drinking water. And then so we're giving some popcorn. So he's eating popcorn.
Ain't that something, eating paper, popcorn, drinking water?
Yep.
I hate to expect him to gain any weight, Morgan. Feed that dog some food. He's hungry.
I noticed after we gave him quite a bit of popcorn, he was licking his chops, and so I went back and got him some water, brought it up here. And
Lord have mercy. Poor old Jack.
I just want to say I wish you all the best here coming up this race in Charlotte, Morgan. That's going to be a busy weekend in Charlotte.
Yeah, well, it's busy now, trying to get ready for it.
I bet you are.
Yeah, we hope you can do what you need to do and qualify car up in the front there.
Yeah, we put a lot of time in our car. We built all new side skirts and trying to get up to date on some of that stuff.
Yeah.
I think we've lost video, folks, but we do have audio going on the line anyway. I don't know. I heard that thing beep twice. That CPU must have got up there at 100 or something.
That's fanning.
Yeah, we need
nothing like the Whoop, man, for equipment messing up. You know what I mean, Morgan? There's nothing like equipment messing up.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
You're talking about Danica being flexible and everything. She's showing some exercise and stuff she's doing. I looked at some pictures where she's exercising. If I did what she did, I'd be in traction for a year.
Yeah, she can bend backwards about double.
Yeah, beats all I've ever seen.
She can bend backwards better than I can bend my arm forward. Bless her heart.
Yeah. Well.
Well, Morgan.
Morgan, did you have hobo beans while you was gone?
No, didn't have no hobo beans. We ate out mostly. We did fix up a bologna burger. I hadn't had bologna in probably 30 years. Walmart and got some of that thick bologna and got some Vidalia onions and.
There you go.
Green pepper and put a little olive oil in the pan and fried that stuff up and boy, it smelled good.
Now, Morgan, there used to be a place I used to fish at up here on Watts Bar. There's a little store up there to cut that bologna off that hump,
Yeah.
And I tell them, I say, and that's when we go fish tournament or something at night. I stop up there and get me a couple of them bologna sandwiches. Throw them in the ice box.
Woo!
Man, 1 o'clock in the morning come around, they wasn't nothing like it.
I'll tell you the best way to bologna sandwich, Morgan, but don't like me. Slice of onion and put mayonnaise on it, and I used to eat that all the time.
I put mustard on mine.
Yeah, me too.
Mustard's good too, but onions, I just can't eat onions no more.
I don't like mustard.
Yeah, I like mustard and fried onions and green peppers. My wife and I, we left and came back and opened the door, and boy, that smelled good.
Mm.
I said, don't our motorhome smell good?
She knows how to smell one up, don't she?
Well, Morgan, we'll let you get back to the car then, I guess.
Okay. Well, God bless all my friends out there that support us. We appreciate them. My old buddy Carlos Courtney down there in Texas, I tell you, just like it ain't going to never stop raining for that guy.
Boy, I know it.
They've been having it, don't they?
Yeah, just kills the construction work.
Yeah.
But we sure appreciate everybody that helps us. We stuck a new ECR engine in the car this week.
We should be good for Charlotte, shouldn't we?
Yeah.
We hope.
I get these wheels turning right.
There you go.
Turn them forward, not backwards.
Yeah.
Morgan, be good, and we'll be watching you.
All right. You guys keep whooping up.
All right. See you, buddy.
Bye.
All right. Bye.
Morgan Shepherd, number 89. We'll be right back.
Are you looking for a new salon or stylist? Well, let me give you a little heads up. Heads Up Hair Design, that is. Heads Up Hair Design, located at 60 Mouse Creek Road. Call Carmen Wilson at 476-5722 for your appointment. And as always, walk-ins are welcome. Stop in and see the good folks at Heads Up Hair Design. Welcome to L&B Appliance Sales, 160 Durkee Road Northeast in Cleveland, Tennessee. 339-3231 is that phone number. Owned and operated by Jason Taylor. Why choose L&B Appliance Sales? Great prices on top brands. The best selection of appliances and home furnishings. Friendly, helpful, and knowledgeable salespeople. Professional installation and service. L&B Appliance Sales carries a large selection of appliances and home furnishings, including refrigerators, cooktops, ovens, ranges, washers, and dryers. If you are looking for appliances or home furnishings in the area, be sure to shop at L&B Appliance Sales. And before you go to their showroom, be sure to check out L&B Appliance Sales special offers, discounts, rebates, and financing special on top brand merchandise like Amana, Electrolux, Frigidaire, Whirlpool, and Maytag. L&B Appliance Sales is part of the Brands Direct network of independent dealers. Brands Direct dealers offer their customers the best names in brand appliances, furniture, and electronics through the nation's single largest network of independent stores. Brands Direct have a store close to you with knowledgeable local salespeople. L&B Appliance Sales is the right choice for the discriminating shopper.
The new Hardee's Midnight Moonshine Thick Burger. It's not for everyone. It's not for you if you once tried moonshine, then call the cops on yourself. And if your idea of bootlegging is illegally taping your favorite jam band, it's not for you. But if you like the sweet burn of moonshine glaze on Black Angus beef, it's for you. The Midnight Moonshine Thick Burger. Only at Hardee's.
For a limited time, participating restaurant cooked product contains some alcohol. The Midnight is a registered trademark of Piedmont Distillers Incorporated, Madison, North Carolina.
The sun is out, the kids are home, and you're ready to make this summer one they'll never forget. Gather up the family and head over to Lake Winnie, the South's best value amusement park, where there's excitement for everyone. Watch the little ones light up as they experience attractions like the flying elephants and the bumblebees. Get your thrill-seeking hearts racing as you free-fall 14 stories on the Ozone and see if you can stomach the all-new Twister ride. You'll flip over it. Then, satisfy your taste buds with delicious treats like the legendary funnel cakes. With so much to offer and so close to home, Lake Winnie is the perfect place for every family to have fun together. Now open Thursday through Monday. On Thursdays, bring a canned food item and save $5 on an unlimited ride ticket. Sponsored by WRCV-TV. For more information, visit lakewinnie.com.
Hi, everybody. It's Pat Patterson, the Racing Guy. Don't miss this week's Whoop on Wheels. WOOP-FM 99.9, Fast Eddie, Big G, and Bullet got all your racing news. I'm Pat Patterson. Don't miss it this week.
When you're in the mood for frozen yogurt, come to Cleveland's Original, Turkett's, 3506 Keith Street Northwest, located in the same plaza as Gondolier. Turkett's Yogurt. Come see Roger Turpin at Turkett's, 476-1668. Perkett's Yogurt. Often imitated, never duplicated.
Hey, kids, with Pizza Hut's $5 flavor menu, we get any two or more of our favorites for just $5 each.
So, like, medium one-topping pizzas for $5?
Yes.
What about two pizzas and wing street wings?
Yes.
Two pizzas, wings, breadsticks, and a cookie?
Yes.
Okay, no pizzas, 12 Hershey's cookies, still $5 each?
Yes.
Can I join the circus?
Yes. What? No, just eat your pizza.
Feels good to say yes to your Pizza Hut favorites for just $5 each. The $5 flavor menu, only at Pizza Hut.
Limited time offer. Additional charge for extra cheese toppings and pan crust. Hershey's trademark used under license.
When Fast Eddie and Big G want to take in a little dirt track racing, it's a good bet they're going to stop in at Quick Burger on South Lee Highway. Quick Burger, Monday through Saturday, 10:30 to 6. Call-in orders are always welcome. That phone number is 472-0463. Stop in and see Ramel Daffron and her crew, Brenda, Rob, Ryan, Ashley, Dawn, and Betty, for the best burger in town. An extensive menu, plate specials, chicken sandwiches, and the best hot dog as well. Check in with Quick Burger on South Lee Highway. When Big G and Fast Eddie need to make a pit stop for lunch, they head to Quiznos. Stop in and see Roger Patel and his crew at Quiznos Sub, 2151 Keith Street. Phone number 473-7976. For all your box lunches and catering needs, stop in and see the folks at Quiznos Sub. Quiznos. Toasty.
Hi, everybody. It's Pat Patterson, the racing guy. If you love your NASCAR, you got to love Whoop on Wheels. Tune in this week, 99.9 FM. Be sure to catch Fast Eddie, Big G, and Bullet. They got it all right there for you.
The sun is out, the kids are home, and you're ready to make this summer one they'll never forget. Gather up the family and head over to Lake Winnie, the South's best value amusement park, where there's excitement for everyone. Watch the little ones light up as they experience attractions like the flying elephants and the bumblebees. Get your thrill-seeking hearts racing as you free-fall 14 stories on the Ozone and see if you can stomach the all-new Twister ride. You'll flip over it. Then, satisfy your taste buds with delicious treats like the legendary funnel cakes. With so much to offer and so close to home, Lake Winnie is the perfect place for every family to have fun together. Now open Thursday through Monday. Every Friday, buy one unlimited ride ticket and receive another for half off with a Dr. Pepper or any Coca-Cola can. For more information, visit lakewinnie.com.
When the Whoop on Wheels crew gets back from a long weekend spent in the infield in Talladega, their first stop in town is Surf's Up Car Wash. Surf's Up, 2575 Guthrie Street Northwest, located next to Cleveland Utilities, 790-5793. Surf's Up Car Wash, voted Cleveland's best 3 years in a row. Stop by and see Mike Royville and his gang at Surf's Up.
Welcome to the Island of Whoop
at 99.9 FM.
Your hometown oasis. Whoop FM.
Whoop, whoop.
Radio 99.
Whoop on wheels.
Whoop on wheels.
Whoop Radio is your racing station. Tuesday nights at 7.
You got Big G, Fast Eddie, and the Bullet.
Call 614-5553.
All right, buddy.
Whoop on wheels. Your connection to NASCAR and Talladega on Whoop Island.
Whoop, whoop.
Radio 99.
Hello, Dan. It's Fast Eddie here.
Fast Eddie, how are you doing?
Doing good, Dan. We got Fast Eddie, Big G, and the Bullet in the house here, the Whoop Studios.
The Whoop? I'm here at a car show at the Varsity in Nelsonville looking at a lot of pretty cars.
Oh, I bet you are. Yeah.
Buy us one or two.
Yeah, buy me one.
Tell me something. I have never been to Dawsonville. From Cleveland, Tennessee, how do you get to Dawsonville?
Blue Ridge.
Go up to Blue Ridge?
That's the way I went, Blue Ridge.
Yeah, that's usually the best way to go. And because my daughter went to Lee up there at Cleveland, and that was pretty neat trip for us. And we just went through Blue Ridge and up that way and cut across. And that was the quickest, easiest way to get there.
How long does it take to get to Dawsonville from here, would you say?
2 hours?
Hour and a half, hour and 45 minutes.
How long, Dan?
About an hour and a half, hour and 45 minutes.
Yeah, I thought it was almost 2 hours.
Yeah.
You know, if you stop and sightsee, stuff like that, you know, take you about another 30 minutes. So.
Well,
exactly.
Dan's got a full hour here, so we're going to turn the floor over to him. And he was going to talk about, he'll tell us what he's going to talk about.
Well, you know, I wanted to ask you first off, what did you think about the race from Charlotte this past weekend as far as the format and what you thought about the race altogether? Just wanted to get your idea, your opinion.
Well, I think they got that thing all messed up in my book. I don't know what Big G thinks about it, but I think it's the way they do that stuff. I thought, why don't you race, put the laps out there, you're going to race 100-something laps, run them. Don't run 10 or 15 and stop and get too tired. Hey, let's race like they did back in the Winston Cup days.
Well, you know, I looked at that, and I thought to myself during the time that they're running this, you know, we've done gotten into the deal, and I think that's where a lot of people, myself, and I can speak for myself only, you've got a lot of viewers that you may be in contact with, but, you know, when you look at the formats of the race and everything, it really doesn't change a lot unless there's a wreck. The same people that are winning just kind of keep winning. You may have a situation sometimes, maybe like Talladega or Daytona, where there's a big wreck and takes out some of the contenders, and it shakes things up a little bit. But for the most part, they get out there and run around, they stretch out, and you don't see very much racing, and it's usually about the same people that win every time, or there's a group that seems to be within that group. And right now it looks like the Hendrick cars and the Toyota cars, and if it weren't for Penske with the Fords, you know, the Fords wouldn't even be in the races this year.
You got that right.
But I'd love to see the cars, you know, they've gotten so clean, and you know, you gotta ask yourself, what's NASCAR? You know, what do they want? Do they like this look? Do they like the formats and the way they're racing? Because I still liked it better back when the cars were dirtier, when they didn't get through the air as well, and it was more up to the driver
right.
to make the cars work with whatever situation they were given. But
yeah.
You know, another thing I noticed too from that race up there is, you know, when you look at the drivers and the crews and they interview some of these people and all, is anybody happy to be there?
Well,
it seems like it's a chore for them to be there, or they don't really. I just don't see the passion that you used to see.
Yeah.
Years ago.
Now, Dan, let me ask you a question. You asked us a question too last week. You know why? You know what about the people in the stands? You know why can't we fill the stands anymore?
Oh yeah.
Well, me and Fast Eddie, we went to Talladega. And I just about, if I offend anybody, I don't think I'm going to be sorry about it, because I'm going to say what I'm going to say. Back when you was racing, you and Bill, you know, Darrell Walter, Dale Earnhardt Sr., and all you guys, when you was running, you know, you was more friendly with the fans. Today, me and Fast Eddie, we was down there. And we had pit passes, we had media passes, we had every kind of pass to get anywhere we wanted to get.
And you still couldn't talk to them.
You could not talk to the first driver. They turned their back on you and didn't even want to talk to you. That's what's wrong with the sport.
Yeah, that's a lot what's wrong with it. But, you know, that's why I love right now, I've been watching a lot of the drag racing, been to some of the drag races, and I love the fact that you can walk up next to the cars while they're running and let your eyes burn with that methanol just like
right.
you do, and talk to the drivers and the crew, and they'll talk to you most of the time, and you can be right down there with it, and I love that part of it.
Right.
I don't know how NASCAR got so far removed from that, but I still love the interaction with the crews and being close to the cars and seeing everything, and it is a little bit different environment, but you know, if NASCAR's happy with this and that's where they want to go, then that's so be it. That's what it's going to have to be. But I still like the cars. As I said, I like the cars a little bit dirtier to where it leaves a lot for the driver to make up. Back when Cale was driving and Richard and Buddy Baker, you know, you had to manhandle the cars to get them around the racetrack.
Right.
Now, if you make a mistake, you made a bad mistake. It's kind of like Kyle Larson at the end of that race.
Correct.
You know, just one little bobble and you hit the wall.
Yeah.
We had his spotter on a few minutes ago.
Wow.
And talking about that, Kyle, it was great. I mean, I just hated it. I was like seeing him win it, but.
Yeah, I would too. It would have been great because there's somebody that, you know, that. He's paying his dues just like everybody else and coming up through. But, you know, I just see, was there a lot of people at Talladega? Were the grandstands full at Talladega?
No.
I'd say probably, three-quarter maybe?
Yeah, about three-quarter.
Or maybe a little high, a little over high full.
They wasn't full.
No, I've seen it fuller.
I would say you could have got a seat anywhere in there. Well, not anywhere in there, but you could have got a seat.
Yeah.
You know, back when we were running, we could go, if we were in the infield and let's say they were going to have a format, well, let's say that they had the twins like they used to have at Daytona. Now it's the duels. If we were in the first race at Daytona and we finished it and wanted to walk up to the grandstands, you know, we were welcome to do that. We just show our garage price,
right,
and go right on up the grandstands. And if it wasn't reserved seating, just sit anywhere you want to sit. And nowadays, you can't even get to the grandstands unless you got a grandstand ticket.
Right.
I don't care what kind of price you've got.
That's right.
Yeah.
I got a quick question for Dan, Fast Eddie Big G. I don't know if it's always been like this. You know, in the All-Star race, one of the guys, I don't remember who it was, they didn't pit, and they penalized him because he didn't pit. Should that be the driver's choice?
Well, you know, that format was so messed up there, and that was a mandatory deal, according to what they said. But, you know, I didn't look that hard for the rules before the race, but that race for the fans, I think, was very confusing on what the rules were supposed to be.
For me, it was.
And not a lot of that was explained, and, you know, even some of the drivers and crews were confused about what the rules were.
Big G said it was Matt Kenseth.
Matt Kenseth, yeah, because the pits closed. When three laps to go, that's when the pits closed. You was not allowed to pit before the three laps. You could pit before the three laps, but after three laps, the pits closed.
Yeah, but when the caution came out and they closed pit road, then he couldn't come down pit road.
He could not. Yeah, he couldn't come down pit road. That's why he got penalized.
Yep, that's why he got penalized. So he sat out there and waited on him to open pit road. Well, by the time they did, then he was done in the penalty. So, but that's one of those deals where, you know, you gamble. Sometimes you win, sometimes you lose.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I didn't like the format. I'm like Fast Eddie. I didn't care for the format. So,
you know, it's almost as if you could get down and run every one of the races, not every one, but the majority of the races that I've seen so far, you can get down and probably run a 25 or a 35 lap race and the outcome still not be much different than what it would be if it's 400 laps or 500.
What I've seen on there is if you're leading the race with 20 or 40 laps to go, you're more or less going to win the race.
Yeah, you're out in clean air, and unless somebody has the wherewithal to run you down and make you bobble, make you move, then no, you're pretty much in catbird seat.
Yeah, that's what happened to Kyle Larson.
Now, Dan, I guess it was Dover. Ain't that where Chase bobbled or something and somebody went around him? Or I thought he was going to win it, Chase was, but.
Well, wasn't it he and Kyle Larson that got into a. They were driving their hearts out up there, and I'm amazed that they. That neither one of the three that were up front wrecked.
Yeah.
I was amazed that they finished that race. They absolutely drove their hearts out because it was one of those situations to where if any one of the bobbles could have took the other two out or took themselves out, but they drove clean and they might have touched each other for a brief second, but shoot, that's the kind of racing you want to see.
Yeah.
I think Chase ended up getting in the wall a little bit, and I think that's what slowed his momentum up. If that hadn't happened, I think Chase could have won it.
Because he was up in the booth watching, and he wasn't commenting, you know. Yeah. He was to the end, you know.
Yeah. Well, you got a situation, too, where you make a run on somebody, you get the tires really hot, and you're running side by side, or you're really trying to get by somebody, and you get the tires hot, and you got to back off and cool them and make one more run.
Right.
I thought that was kind of what was going to happen, but it didn't. But sometimes you can overheat the tires, and they just they're a little bit different. Maybe it's in diameter or something that changes when they go through their heat cycle, and they might not cool down and be the same. So it comes down to the setup at the end and who's got the best.
And I know that, you know, you're talking about cooling down. I've heard them talk. I think Darrell Walter, for one of them, says that, well, these tires that they got now, once they cool off, I think they get a little harder. And and it makes the tire better, he says, for a few laps once they get cooled off. And you know, it's just like putting a set of stickers on. But they don't last as long as a set of stickers do.
No, and sometimes you can use them up catching the car that you're trying to pace, and by the time you get there, you done got so much heat in them, they won't grip. So,
right. Now, what about side drafting? Was that anything during your racing era, is the side drafting ordeal? I mean, I know we've been hearing it for the last, 10 years?
Yeah, but you got to understand that during the times that we ran, if you had a car that had any wind tunnel time, it was Daytona and Talladega cars. And everything else, the cars, as I said before, were pretty dirty. They didn't get through the air really well. And it was well up into the late 80s and early 90s before everybody started concentrating really on wind tunnel time and how slick they could make the cars and the bodies and what they could get by with getting by the templates. But now you've got that one template that goes across the car, and, you know, all of them are the same anymore.
Yeah, I watched I can't remember the guy's name, but I watched a video. He raced back when Bill and him raced, when you all raced. Let me see if I can find. He was a kind of independent racer. I think he was from Louisiana. He drove a green car, and that's, he was kind of talking about a little bit of that stuff. And he was trying to qualify for Daytona, and he didn't get to qualify for Daytona.
Yeah.
And I'm,
the side drafting, like everything else,
I'm trying to think of his name.
You've got to be careful in the side drafting. You can do a little bit of that down the straightaway, but you get in the corner, and it's going to take the wind off the spoiler on both cars usually, and both of you end up wrecking usually, or at least the inside car is the one that suffers the most air loss, and he wrecks and takes you with him.
Right, and I'm trying. Well, you probably know this guy if I can think of his.
Wouldn't be Skip Manning, would it?
That sounds pretty much about what his name was, Skip Manning.
I know he was from Bogalusa, Louisiana.
Yeah.
He ran some during the time that we ran, and he's the only one I remember from Louisiana at the time.
Yeah. He's one of them teams about like what Morgan is now. Kind of had his, you know, volunteers.
Yeah.
He didn't have a pit crew, and his car, you know, he had to beg and borrow and all that, you know, and he had, you know, you're talking about the templates. When he went through spec, he had the whole story on Facebook. When he went through spec, the template wouldn't fit his car. He had to change the back window on his car because the template wouldn't fit. The front windshield wasn't right, and he had all kinds of stuff wrong, and he made it in 30 seconds. He finally made it on the track to try to qualify, but he didn't get to qualify.
Yeah. Well, you know, it'd be interesting to hear some of the fans. You know, it'd be nice to have a program to where all you had was call-ins and let people, you know, kind of voice their opinion to what particular things that maybe they don't like anymore or the reason maybe that they gave up their tickets somewhere or don't go anymore. Because I know for a lot of the older fans, you know, it comes down to sometimes health issues, sometimes it's money situation, and you really don't know why something is the way it is, because let's face it, you know, our economy is just, it's not where it should be. And I know from short track racing, the local economy drives the local short tracks. So without the local construction, whether you be in framing or drywall or concrete, those type businesses or jobs, you know, the sponsorships that's on the side of most of the short track cars are those, as well as maybe grading and hauling, something like that. And when those businesses aren't making money, then the hobbies, the racing usually is the first thing to go.
Yeah, it is. It's just the same way with, I guess, baseball, football, or any sport. You know, people's not going.
Baseball, football, as far as going to the games is one thing, but on a local level, you can go to the park with a bat and a glove and a ball and play ball.
Right.
You can't go to the local racetrack without a race car and a trailer and a few tubes and a few people.
Yeah.
So it you know, your investment in that deal, you know, you can go to the golf course with a set of clubs, and I know from going to the pawn shop, you can pick up a pretty decent set of clubs for $200-$300.
Correct.
And building a race car is not exactly cheap to do.
Now, you know, and that's what we try to advertise on here a whole lot, that, you know, they're talking about one time how much it costs to go to a Dallas Cowboy football game. You know, it's, you know, up in the $1,000 just take your family of three to go to a football game and go to a race at Talladega or, you know, Charlotte or, you know, Bristol, whatever. You know, a family of three can probably spend $200-$300.
Yeah, let me ask you something else too that I encountered when I was at track that I ran for a while is how does the younger generation feel about racing being environmentally correct? Have you thought about that?
Well, I haven't thought about that.
Because you look at it, and that's one thing I've said for a long time, is I've never seen a sport that has so much waste, and it's changed a lot in that aspect, because back when we first started going, you would put a set of spark plugs in and go qualify. You'd pull those out, throw them on the bench, put another set in, go out and run some more, pull those out, put another set in. You pull tires off, and a set of tires then was probably about $600-$800. And you run those in practice, pull them off, and those are thrown away. And even today, when you look, a lot of that has cleaned up over time, because usually a couple of sets of spark plugs will be all you'll use in a weekend. Tires, it depends on what NASCAR dictates that you can have during a race event. But when you consider the fuel, the tires, all the things that you're doing and what it is environmentally, because I had this thrown at me at the track, was I called a person that I had known for a long time and had sponsored some with Dale Earnhardt Sr. when they were running back in the 80s, and they were a local company, and I called them up and asked them about sponsorship because I knew them personally, and they sent me to the marketing department, and I talked to the marketing department, and he said, you know, I'd love to help you, but, you know, racing's not just, it's just not environmentally correct.
Yeah.
And that really opened my eyes as to what maybe, and I don't know, because I've not asked a lot of people that question, but maybe that's one that needs to be asked, if that even figures in.
Well, you're true. I mean, that's true. It should be figured in. Yeah, that's a big question.
But you know, if they say this about racing, if racing's not environmentally correct, you know, you've got a good many small airplanes that carry the teams to the races back and forth. But when you consider all of the baseball, football, basketball games that happen just in the United States, and how many planes crisscross the USA each and every day carrying ball teams to games, events, activities, things like that. Not even the players that have their own private planes. When you think about the footprint that those leave on the environment, would be just as bad or worse than running a 300, 400, 500 mile event.
Yeah. That's the truth there, Dan. No.
And I don't know that nobody considers that very much, but, you know, all of this stuff, I would love to know. I'd love to have an idea of what the younger fans, you know, why aren't the younger fans doing as much? Because it's just like this car show here tonight. We don't have a lot of young folks here. It's all older generation people who have grown up with cars and hot rods and stuff, or maybe they couldn't afford them when they were younger and now they can.
Yeah.
But it's just a different group of people, and we just don't see as many kids.
Wow.
Yeah, I don't know. I can't answer that question, really. I haven't heard, you know, anything about it. Even, you know, like I said, when me and Eddie went down to Talladega, we, you know, didn't hear, you know, anything talk about, you know, anything environmental on it.
No, and you probably won't, because those people probably aren't going to come to the race anyway. If they're thinking this is environmentally incorrect anyway, then they're not going to be there anyway.
Yeah.
They're not going to support it. And is that a factor in some of the younger people not coming? Is it something that maybe this company was just trying to blow me off and said that so that I'd leave them alone?
Yeah. Well, the thing about it, I think, you know, me personally, I think NASCAR has made it more environmentally better. I guess, you know, running the ethanol type fuels and, what they're doing with the tire situation. It has to be a whole lot better than it was back in the, you know, 70s and 80s and even in the 90s.
Yeah, I know with Safety Clean being involved, I know that the waste from the lubricants, the oils, the greases, and that stuff, you know, they have really cleaned that part up. And at the racetrack, they've got parts washers and stuff, and you can use, and all of that stuff is maintained, and there's not anything that gets into the ground, and not any concerns in that aspect anymore. But it's still one. I just left the to quiz a few of the younger people and if that's even a concern or not.
I wish that we had more than one phone line here where we could open that up and find out, you know, but
it would be nice.
It would be. I've been preaching for that I've been here probably over 10 years, and we need more than one line here to this station.
But anyway, it's just things to think about. It's just things that come up, and whether or not it makes a difference or not, it's not going to be one thing that has hurt attendance at the races, or even the fact that you've got fewer teams that are able to come anymore. It's not one particular thing. It's going to be a combination of things.
Dan, who would you pick at this moment that you think that would be the chase, that would win the chase? Or is that too hard for you to figure out right now?
You know, you can pretty much, based on what you've seen to this point, you know that right now there are probably, I would have told you a year before life that there was one super team, and that would be Hendrick. And I would say that you're down to, for the most part, you're down to three organizations, I think, that are right now that are dominant. Hendrick, Penske, and Gibbs. And you know that out of those, you've got probably one or two drivers out of each one of those that are capable of a championship. And unless something happens, one of those guys is going to walk away with it at the end of the year. And you've got to know that Kyle Busch is still hot, that's for sure. You're not going to count out Jimmy Johnson. You're not going to count out even Little Lee. He's had some troubles, but you can't count him out either. And Keselowski, you've got to look at him or Logano, because they're all hungry for the wins and a championship.
What about Martin Truex?
You know, up to now, he's run really well. I think he's poised for it, but it may take just a little bit longer. I would see Martin run really well and buy for a championship. No problem there. But I'd say at this point in the game, it'd be a little bit hard for him.
Is that because he might be a...
Count him out, though.
That might be because he's a smaller team?
Well, I think it's just up to now, you really got to have, whether you make your own luck or whether it is luck, whether it's just preparation, we just know that some of the other teams, when it comes down to the end, they can seal the deal at the end of the race.
I'll tell you a driver, Dan, I wouldn't count out, and that is Kurt Busch. He's actually third in points, and he has won a championship before, too.
I know, but we're in a situation now that is really different from what it used to be.
Yeah.
And the only thing you've got to do now is get into that life number that gets you into the chase, because nothing else matters.
Yeah, points right now don't make a hill of beans.
No.
Look at what Kyle Busch did last year.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How many races did he miss last year?
Eight, well, or more.
13.
13, yeah, 13.
Gosh.
You know, that would be unheard of.
Points can change in a week or two.
Yeah, and when it gets down to that chase at the very end, like I say, all you've got to do is put yourself in that position to where you're there at the end, and any one of those cars has a chance to win the championship.
I'm going to tell you something. It may not be this year, but next year or the next, look at Chase taking one of these. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I know exactly what you mean.
I think he'll be there.
I look at all these drivers coming up, because you've seen it out of Kyle Larson, you've seen it out of Chase. You've got a few drivers coming along right now that will be serious contenders in the next year, 2 years, and even Kyle Larson, maybe, if he keeps running good, might be a contender this year. Like I say, if you put yourself in a position where you can get into the chase at the end of the year, I think anything is possible once you get to there.
If they keep on giving that little Blaney boy some good cars, the Wood brothers, he's a good player.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. So, I mean, even though they're just a single-team car, I mean, you know, they got good equipment and they got a little driver right there can do it.
You've got to know that any time that it seems like Penske has been, they've been the only one that's been consistent on a Ford running up front.
Right.
And you've got to have consistency, but as I said, all you've got to do is get yourself in the chase, and I think it'll make a lot of difference.
Do you think next year with Stuart Haas going to Ford's, is that going to hurt him or help him? I think it'll help him.
You know, that's one of those things that only time will tell, but I don't know if it'll make a lot of difference. I don't know where they're going to end up getting. Are they going to get their engines from Penske?
Roush, ain't it?
Roush, where they get their motors at.
Who?
I think they'll get theirs from Roush.
That's what I think.
Roush and...
Roush Yates.
Yeah. Roush Yates motors. But
well, I think...
But let me ask you this, though. I mean, let's go back when y'all was doing it to today. Now, you know, back in the older days, I'm going to say back in the 80s, a Ford, to me, was a Ford. A Chevrolet was a Chevrolet. A Dodge was a Dodge. Seemed like this day and time, only thing you got is just a front nose clip and a rear clip. And that's the only difference you got in the cars.
Yeah, and they're not very much different.
No. You know, and I guess I'm being negative about it because it's just it's just got where it's, it just looks too much familiar. If it didn't have a if it didn't have a blue oval on the front of it, if it didn't have the O on it with a Toyota symbol in it, or if it didn't say Camaro on it or Chevrolet on it, you wouldn't know what car is what.
Now, we're done down to the deal. Is there anything that they can do that's going to make you happy about racing, right?
Change it. 100 degree, change it.
Yeah, I know, but you know they may have a different plan than we've got. So I know they're running a whole lot different than I would, and they've just got to keep running it because I don't have the money to be in the position they're in, and don't see that happening in the immediate future. So they'll just have to keep running it like they see fit, and. You know, with the TV money and the radio money, do they need anybody in the grandstands?
Well, I think they do to keep the tracks open. I really do. I think I know the drivers are busy. It seems like the drivers are busier now. Because me and Eddie, and Eddie fools with a lot of the PR people more than I do. PR people is just something, I don't know. I think it's just somebody just have an extra person on the payroll.
Well, I think they field, you know, they're the front people for the drivers and all because they're fielding all the people. They're the ones kind of the safety net between the drivers and the media people. And they're there for a reason. They're put there to run interference and keep everything structured, I guess, if you want to call it.
Well, I mean, it keeps the driver on track, more or less.
Yeah, but, you know, with all the way the things that are done for a driver now, a driver should have a lot of time. You know, I know there's meetings and different things that a driver has to do, but the drivers don't work on their cars anymore.
Nope.
They go to the meetings, and I know they have personal appearances, personal services contracts, things like that, but they should have more time today than the drivers did during our decade of the 80s.
Right. See, that's my whole point about, I've been on both sides of fences. I've helped Morgan McClure out with number 4 team. I've been on a crew, helped on a crew, and back then, we was more friendlier to the people than what they are today. Even when me and Eddie goes to a race, like I said, we got every credential to get in wherever we want to go to. Okay? You can't even talk to a crew member anymore. They don't even want to talk to you.
Yeah,
they're sitting there on their rear end not doing nothing.
Yeah, but also too, you don't know what's been told to them about talking to the media.
Yeah, you see,
that's true.
That's something that's changed since I've been doing it.
Exactly. And I know from experience that they do not want anybody to talk to the media except the representative that's supposed to talk to the media.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the PR person.
Well, see, we don't even introduce ourselves as being with a radio station. We just try to be like a fan, you know, and talk to them.
Yeah, and that's not going to work at all.
You know. And
yeah,
it just don't work.
It just don't work. But you know, it is their environment. They're there to do a job. They're concentrating on what they're supposed to do. And you know, it's kind of the way it's evolved over the years. I don't like it as much either, but it's the way it is. And we either support the sport or we find something else to do.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we'll support it because we like it.
Yeah, we'll
you know.
Like it and hope at some point in time that it will come around to what we like or something that
yeah.
We like better. But at this point in time, as it's been said, it's the only game in town, and if you want to play, you play.
Yeah. Well, there's another thing, too, that was brought up, and I've seen it, you know, go around in circles, even on TV, talking about you know, they're talking about doing away with the prayer at the racetrack and the national anthem. And the first thing that was, you know, was brought out, well, let's get rid of Mr. France, you know. And, I mean, you know, he'd be the first one that needs to go because he's the one that's pushing it. That's just what I've seen. I don't know nothing else about it, just what I've been seeing on TV and been hearing through the media.
Well, I know one thing for sure as far as, and this is my personal view, and I'm not forcing it on anybody. It's just my personal view, and I'll leave it at that, as I thank God for everything that happened with us and the opportunities that were afforded to us, because I know without the faith that I know I wouldn't be the person that I am today without that.
Right.
And I thank God for it.
Yeah.
My mom and dad, everything that I am, I owe to him. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I agree with you.
That's right.
100%. Just like me and you talked about on the phone. If it wasn't for him intervening with me, I'd probably be sitting in prison somewhere.
Yeah, because day-to-day life can get pretty tough sometimes, and unless you have faith in something and believe in something. And like I say, I thank God for what I've got and for being where I am today.
Yeah. Now, Dan, did you tell us, I'm jumping gears here, did you tell me on the phone that you now work out of where the museum was?
Yeah, I'm in the building that used to be the museum there on the main complex where Ernie's building. I had another building there at one time. I sold to Ernie, and then Bill got his building there. And then the original building that we started out in was it was a shop that my dad built for a truck shop, because we had a building supply and he needed a place to work on trucks. So that was the first building that we worked out of. And I work out of what used to be the old museum, and it just for me, I love working in that building, because you know you don't want to live in the past, and I try to keep everything in perspective. But I love the fact that the $1 million car was done in that room, that my grinding room is the paint booth, where the paint booth was, and I love the fact that the $1 million car was done in that room. All the cars that competed up until about 88, might have been the first of 89, was all done in that building. And I just love the history aspect of it. It's not that I want to live in the past. It's just the history aspect of it. I just think it's neat.
Yeah, it is.
Now, did you all have another garage that y'all worked out of that wasn't there on that complex?
Yeah, we actually, when my dad bought the Ford dealership in Dahlonega, which was about 15 miles, 20 miles away from Dawsonville, in Dahlonega, we moved the race team up there for a period of time. And I can remember the car that we got from Penske, which was that Cam 2 Mercury. I can remember it being in that building. So the period would have had to been somewhere around 77, 78.
Okay.
When it moved away, but we were still all working together. My dad had the Ford dealership, and I was working on the dealership side of it, and then working at night on the race cars and helping with the race cars. And Bill and Ernie were working pretty much full time on the race cars, all there in the same building. It made it pretty neat as far as everything being there together, but the race team needed separation from the dealership, and it worked out at the time, but then outgrew that and moved back to Dawsonville.
Now, I remember, might be back in the 90s, early 90s. Now, Bill, he started driving for Budweiser back in the 90s, right?
Yeah, 92.
Now, okay, 92. I remember going to one of the shops that he had. I wanted that hood so bad I couldn't stand it. I didn't get it. There was one guy there. Bill wasn't there. I don't know who the guy was. He was, I think, just over the shop or looking over the shop. And, you know, he let me go in and look. And we went to the museum first, where you're talking about you're at now,
mm-hmm.
where your shop is. Then when they told us that we could go to another place, and that's where they kept the cars, and that's where they worked on the car, that's why I asked you about that. And we went there, and he had one of the Budweiser hoods, and it was up on the wall, and it was had been in a – he got into a wreck, I think, at Darlington with it.
Yeah, but now this would have been probably the Bush car that they ran out of there, because all of the Cup cars that were the Bud cars that he was running with Junior were all done out of Junior's shop.
Okay.
Up there at Wilkesboro.
Okay. It might have been, but I wanted the hood anyway.
Yeah, I understand that one.
And I told him, I said, I wish Bill was here. I probably could get it. And he said, well, you probably could if he was here.
So,
but it was bent all to pieces.
So Bill's cars, the big race sprint cars now, but Winston Cup back then, were not his, right? They were Junior's cars.
When he ran for Budweiser with Junior, and when the years he ran for Junior, that was all Junior's equipment. All Bill had to do was show up and drive.
Oh, okay. Then Bill had his own cars, right? Not the Bush car, but the Winston Cup car. On his own.
Well, Bill had one car that they ran in the 94 season that, let's see, Bobby Hillen drove a little bit. He had several drivers because he was trying to field some cars before he came home in 95 with the McDonald's sponsorship.
Yeah.
And 95 was when he came back to Dawsonville and started running out of the shops there and owned his own equipment.
Now, Dan, let me ask you a question. This is a question that's been on my mind, and I want to ask you, and you don't have to tell me anything if you don't want to. That's fine. But a story that I got that Bill made a comment one time after he, you know, after Mellon left and he started driving for Junior and the Budweiser, then he got the McDonald's sponsorship. He said that he would never drive for another beer sponsor. Do you know if there's any truth to that or not? Now, I didn't hear that from Bill. I just heard that's just something that come out in the tabloids.
If there's any truth or not, I don't know. I've never heard that, or I don't know, and that's the honest truth.
Okay.
I don't know.
Bill drove for Coors, didn't he?
Yeah, we drove
Mellon Coors. Yeah.
And we were involved with them, and then he got with Budweiser. But you know the thing I loved about Peter Coors was the one we dealt with at the time, and that was one of the things that my dad had the hardest time with. And you know, Peter and Daddy had a conversation, and Peter told Daddy that he didn't really care. Peter did not really care whether we drank or not. If we did, he wanted us to drink the beer. That's all they ever had.
Yeah.
And there was never any pressure from them for us to do anything. Now I'm talking about myself, and there was never any pressure for us to do anything other than just be under their sponsorship.
Yeah.
They didn't ask us to drink. They didn't say anything. They didn't make us do anything at any bars or anything like that, and that was what I respected the most of Peter Coors when we first got together with them.
That's good. That is good respect right there.
That is, and you can't ask for anything better. He said, I don't care whether you drink or not, if you do, drink our beer.
Right. And drinking their beer is about like drinking salt water.
Well, it's a matter of preference, and I have a lot of respect for that family for what was done for us at that time. You know, were it not for them, I don't know. I'm sure we would have gotten a sponsor, but they helped a long way.
Mm-hmm.
And really didn't ask a lot from us during that period.
Yeah, that's just like, you know, you don't even have cigarettes on cars anymore. And just about, you know, Bush is about the only one. Well, you still got Budweiser, but that's about the only two beer cars that you see on the track anymore.
Yeah, it's sponsorship has changed, but I know that who regulates that now? Is it the FCC that regulates that?
What, the beer or?
Yeah, the beer and cigarette sponsorship, tobacco sponsorship.
Yeah, uh-huh.
It's being regulated. I don't know who regulates it, but it's being regulated, and you can only do so much anymore.
I think it's food, the Food Administration or something like that. Yeah.
FDA. I don't know who does that, and I'll be, you don't have to have anybody call in and say he don't know what he's talking about. But
right.
But I know somebody is regulating that. I don't know who. You can look it up on the internet, but I don't know who's doing that. I just know it's regulated, and that's all that matters to me is that it's regulated. And they pretty much tell you what you can do, what you can't do, what size it can be, and so forth. And that is, I think it is more than just racing that it's regulated with also.
Now, I know that, I think the cigarette deal is that, and I know that, like you said, you know, NASCAR tells them how big the sign's got to be, how big the sticker can be. It can't be about a certain size. I do know that NASCAR tells them that.
Well, when it comes down to regulations on the race cars, there's always somebody there that's going to tell you what you can and can't do.
Yeah, they can tell you when you probably go get a drink of water.
Not that bad, but pretty close.
Yeah. Well, I'm just being sarcastic about it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, exactly. But, you know, I'd love to. I can remember a time, and I can't remember when they were going to do this, but I can remember a time probably back in the it was sometime in the 80s, they were going to drop cubic inches to where that they were a 311 cubic inch instead of a 358 to try to get the speeds down. And it never happened. I know they ran the V6s some, not in cup, but I know they ran the V6s some. And those were really good engines, and they ran extremely fast at Daytona and Talladega, but you know, I would love to see maybe the cubic inch change to where that you don't have a restrictor plate anymore at Daytona and Talladega, and keep the cars maybe from running in such packs as they run in and make the racing better. But, you know, until you test a little bit of that, because with the cars they have today, these cars are really aero slick. They get through the air well. They're aero dependent. Anything around them, you get another car around them, it changes the characteristics, the driving characteristics of both cars. So, you know, without the testing, you just have no idea what you're in for. You could make a rule change and really shoot yourself in the foot if you didn't do some testing.
Right. Well, I agree with you. You know, now, they had restrictor plates back in your time, didn't they?
Well, actually, they had them before my time because my dad had a car that they ran. I can remember the only race they ran a race at Michigan, and I know it was a 429, so it was prior to 72, and they had a restrictor plate on them, and I think that maybe Daytona, Talladega, Michigan, there were a few places they ran that plate, and I know there's a lot of people that know a lot more about it than I do, but I remember my dad talking about it.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason that he was talking about it was because one of the better running teams, one of the teams that was always up front at that time, which I don't know who it might be, but my dad was talking about they made that restrictor plate out of a sugar mix, and the gasoline dissolved the sugar, and then there was no plate there.
That makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, ingenuity went a long way in that time, and that was, I believe that was 1970.
Right. Yeah, I know, NASCAR governs all that now, and when we was at Talladega, we seen, we was back there where one of the cars wrecked, and it was one of Jimmy Main's cars, and
oh, man.
And it tore that car all pieces. But
The
guy, the mechanic, he took the carburetor off, took the restrictor plate off.
That had to go back to NASCAR, didn't it?
NASCAR grabbed it, and he didn't look back.
Yeah, exactly, because they're there when you put them on, they're there when you take them off, and if something goes amiss that they're not there when it comes off, then the motor's coming out of the car and it's getting checked. So they do their homework on that one, and you're not going to what you could get by with back years ago. There are gray areas and areas that you could fudge a little bit, but that's all pretty much gone by the wayside. And if you're going to do anything anymore, it's pretty much blatant. You're going to intentionally do something. There are very few gray areas, if any, left at all. And like I say, it's black and white anymore.
Well, they got one of the best cheaters in there to check all that, and that's Andy Petrie.
Well, there's quite a few of those. It's quite ingenious, but you've also got to understand, too, now you've got fuel injection.
Yeah.
So anytime you throw in electronics, because NASCAR, they weren't too fond of getting into a situation to where that you throw electronics into the mix, but you knew at some point in time it had to come. Now you've got fuel injection. How much of that stuff can you fudge on? I don't know, because these people that do those systems, they are very, very good at their job, and I know that NASCAR pays them a lot of money, or there's money being spent to make sure that that stuff stays legal.
Well, I can tell you this. The people that always trained us was the bad people. You know, I told you about me being a cop.
Yep.
Well, they're the one that trains us.
Yeah, that's absolutely correct.
Okay. One that probably trains NASCAR is the ones that can, that's got by with it for years and years and years.
Well, who do you think, you know, the people that write the programs, who do you think makes the viruses for the program?
I'm going to stop right there.
Yep. So we needn't say any more about it, because we know that there's situations to where that things, there are still some gray areas, and I guess there always will be, but there's fewer than there was.
You're exactly right. Well, what kind of car are you going to buy at that car show?
I think I'm just going to look at them. I think I'm going to be like that deal with your first, you know, the happiest days of your life is when you buy your first boat and sell your first boat.
Now, wait a minute now. I got my boat, and I still got it, and I'm still happy with it.
Yeah, but I go to a car show like this, and I see all the cars that I want. And if I buy one, which I've done before at some of these, and get them home and think, you know, why did I do that?
How many you got? Do you have any old cars?
Well, I'm sure he does.
In your collection?
I'm down to about two cars is about all I've got left. Because it's one of those deals to where that I'd love to have more, but when they sit a lot, it's a lot of upkeep for them to sit.
Yep.
And I've got a Boss 351 Mustang, and I've got a SBO Mustang I bought from my dad before he passed away, and it's an 85 model SBO, and I'll probably end up giving it to my son, and we down to the nitty gritty, and it's just hard to have hot rods anymore up here. I see a police car going by now and the state patrol. They've got to where they sit down here and wait for everybody to leave these shows because everybody likes to kind of do burnouts on the way out. Well,
yeah,
you know, the tickets, they aren't easy to keep paid.
Well,
hey, Dan, will your son, you think he'll be racing?
No, because if he were, he's 22 now. And if he were, he'd have had to been doing it already, because if you're not racing by the time you're 5 years old, you just can't make it into any professional side of this. You've got to be in by 20.
Mm. Well,
oh yeah.
So you think it's too late for him to start?
Absolutely, it's too late.
Mm.
Absolutely, it's too late. It's not like when we were kids, when you could come in at 20, 25 years old, because who's the oldest driver on the circuit now?
Who's the oldest driver on the circuit? Matt Kenseth, probably.
He could be. Or Dale Earnhardt Jr.
No, I think Matt's older than he is. I think Matt's 40-something, 40,
45
or 46.
All right, and how old was Jeff Gordon when he retired?
45.
Yep. I see your point.
Yeah.
Yep. Junior made a statement the other night, and he'd like to win this Coca-Cola 600 before he retires. Is that?
It's already on his mind, isn't it?
Yeah. Is that going to happen within this year or next, maybe?
Well, that's something we don't know, and I'm sure they may not know.
He probably don't know.
But it's on his mind, ain't it? Like you said.
It's on his mind, because if you tear the wall down a time or two, and you know how hard it hurts to be in those wrecks. You know, Jeff, I haven't asked Jeff, but I'll bet if I ask him where he got hurt the worst at was it was one of the night races. He hit the inside wall. I don't remember if it was Phoenix or Vegas or one of those. And he hit the inside wall a ton where there was no safer barrier. I think I've heard that one was where he injured his back, and he never was the same after that.
That's probably about 3 years ago.
Yeah, he had some back trouble from that.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Well, Dan, before I forget, I do want to meet you sometime and come down with something, me and Fast Eddie, and maybe bring Bullet up to it and come down sometime and meet you.
Well, I'll drive your hot rod down and come on down. We'll have a Tuesday night at the Varsity.
The only thing I got is a hot rod Hemi Dodge truck.
That'll be fine. Bring it on.
It ain't got but almost 620 horsepower.
Well, you're down a little bit on horsepower, but bring it anyway.
Well, okay.
I was going to ask Dan one question here. Dan, do you all have any Bill's cars left?
Now,
that he raised.
Bill's got cars left of his.
Wow.
And I don't know how many. I know there's some at the museum here, the Hall of Fame at Dawsonville, and there's some spread out at different places. But he's got some left. But as far as me having any, no, I don't. And you know, as I said, that's one of the things that just couldn't afford to get into that, and I don't know what I'd do with them if I had them.
Yeah.
I'll bring my car hauler.
It'd be a fine museum piece, but other than that,
one more question here before we let you go. See, we did take that whole hour. I know we do. When we have Dan on, we have to have an hour.
I love having him.
Yeah, I do too. Dan, at one point, Bill lived in Blairsville, Georgia, because they would say, Bill Elliott out of Blairsville, Georgia. Now, tell me about that, can you remember?
Well, I just know that, let's see, that was probably the time, that would have been about the time they started driving for Junior, but, you know, a driver doesn't have to live at one particular place anymore. All they got to do is show up at the track and get in whatever they're supposed to get in.
Yeah.
And he lived at different places at different times, and I'd love to be able to do the same thing myself. I just hadn't had the wherewithal to do it. And, you know, whether you travel from Dawsonville or Blairsville or Colorado to a race, just as long as you get there, that's all that's important.
Yeah, that's it.
I got a question for Dan. Fast
all the drivers are, you know, some have moved around. Some are maybe from out west, and now they live in Charlotte, Mooresville, or on Lake Norman, or something like that. Or they live in Florida, because Mark Martin moved to Florida, I think.
Yeah.
Sometime in his career, but he's got a lot of the drivers that's moved around, and it's not important anymore where they're from.
As long as they show up for the race.
Well, so long as they're there with a helmet bag and get there in time to get in the car, that's all they have to do.
Go ahead, Bullet.
Yeah, Dan, was it true that Bill won the first $1 million?
Yes, he did.
Won it at Darlington.
I actually watched that race, and I remember he was overjoyed about that. I don't blame him.
Oh, my. We were all overjoyed about that, because it was, as I said then, that was the year that if anybody had a question whether God was in it or not, if you didn't think so, then that year would have proven anybody wrong, because it was definitely a fairy tale year. And even though there was a couple of races where things didn't go the way you wanted them, it was almost, and I say almost, it was almost a deal where, you know, you could just do no wrong. Other than the championship out of that deal, that was probably the only thing missing out of that year.
Wow.
Well, Dan, sometime or another, we can get you back on. I'd like to have you another an hour.
Oh, we will.
Well, that'll be good. And, you know, the most important thing about this is you're very blessed that you came through this without losing anybody. There was a lot of people who got seriously injured at the tracks, whether on pit road or whether in the cars, and you were very blessed to come through that in the shape you came through it in.
Right.
Right. Listen, Dan, till the next time we get you, I'll give you a shout in a month or two or something and get you back on here again.
Sounds good. You guys have a great night.
All right, Bill. Dan, thank you.
Yeah, it sounds like my mama. Just call her over.
I know it. See you, buddy. Right,
thanks, Dan.
Bye-bye. Bye. Gosh, she sounds like Bill over. That's almost, why I said that.
Almost looks like Bill.
Oh, I know.
There's a picture of him. I'm showing Bullet picture of him.
He does.
He looks almost just like Bill. He just don't have the gray hair like Bill does. He's got the reddish colored hair like Bill.
Yeah.
But anyway, I pulled this page up and I can ask him questions off this one page right here. Probably take up 30 minutes.
I was thinking Bill had won the first $1 million.
He did at Darlington. Yeah, that's why they call him the million dollar Bill.
He's driving the number 9 car, wasn't he?
Number 9, and he was. They went around the track and had a at that time Wells Fargo, I think it was.
I remember watching that race.
And it was throwing fake money out, you know. And Bill was driving behind it.
My doggone cell phone died on me.
Cell phone, there, buddy.
Do you know what? It just sit there and died.
Died.
I know it. Go ahead, caller. You're live on the Whoop.
How you doing, Eddie?
Doing good, Brett. How are you?
How you doing, Big G?
Well, see, my phone's dead.
I'm all
John
right.
Can't get in.
Yeah.
Okay, Brett, I don't want to be rude or anything, but can you call back in about 20 minutes?
Yeah.
All right, buddy.
Right.
Thank you. All right. All right, folks, let's keep the phone lines open. We got John Roberts supposed to be calling in here.
Everybody knows his name, John Roberts.
Yeah. I got a dead phone. I can't even find his telephone number now.
Oh, my goodness.
It just died. It went out. Gosh.
Something's wrong with these phones. I mean, I think I got to charge them too much.
Yeah, but we'll be right back, okay?
This is Barry Houston with Furniture Row Racing, hanging out with Big G and Fast Eddie and Bullet on Whoop on Wheels.
The sun is out, the kids are home, and you're ready to make this summer one they'll never forget. Gather up the family and head over to Lake Winnie, where there's excitement for everyone. The little ones will light up on attractions like the flying elephants and bumblebees. Get your hearts racing as you freefall 14 stories on the Ozone and see if you can stomach the all-new Twister ride. Then, satisfy your taste buds with delicious treats like the legendary funnel cakes. With so much to offer and so close to home, Lake Winnie is the perfect place for every family to have fun together. Open Thursday through Sunday and Monday Memorial Day. Soquia Water Park opens Saturday, May 28th. Don't miss the music of the Band Organ Organization of America, May 28th, 29th, and 30th. So come on over to Lake Winnie and make today a special one. For more information, visit lakewinnie.com.
Whoop on Wheels is proud to be sponsored by the Gondolier, for all your Italian and Greek specialties, as well as the best pizza in town. Gondolier locations are at Okoy, 1603 Highway 64, Benton, Tennessee. That phone number, 338-7299. Stop in and see the fine folks at the Okoy Gondolier. And if you're in the Cleveland area, they're located at 3300 Keith Street, 472-4998. All items at Gondolier can be fixed for you to take home. Proud sponsors of Whoop on Wheels and the Gondolier. For all your pet grooming needs, see the staff at Happy Tails Grooming Salon. Happy Tails, located at 2251 North Okoy Street. Business hours are Tuesday through Friday, 8 to 5:30, Saturday, 9 to 5:30. For your appointment, call 339-5777. A full-service professional groomer. Happy Tails Grooming Salon.
Come shaggy, leave happy. Are you looking for a new salon or stylist? Well, let me give you a little heads up. Heads Up Hair Design, that is. Heads Up Hair Design, located at 60 Mouse Creek Road. Call Carmen Wilson at 476-5722 for your appointment. And as always, walk-ins are welcome. Stop in and see the good folks at Heads Up Hair Design. Welcome to L&B Appliance Sales, 160 Durkee Road Northeast in Cleveland, Tennessee. 339-3231 is that phone number. Owned and operated by Jason Taylor. Why choose L&B Appliance Sales? Great prices on top brands. The best selection of appliances and home furnishings. Friendly, helpful, and knowledgeable salespeople. Professional installation and service. L&B Appliance Sales carries a large selection of appliances and home furnishings, including refrigerators, cooktops, ovens, ranges, washers, and dryers. If you are looking for appliances or home furnishings in the area, be sure to shop at L&B Appliance Sales. And before you go to their showroom, be sure to check out L&B Appliance Sales special offers, discounts, rebates, and financing special on top brand merchandise like Amana, Electrolux, Frigidaire, Whirlpool, and Maytag. L&B Appliance Sales is part of the Brands Direct network of independent dealers. Brands Direct dealers offer their customers the best names in brand appliances, furniture, and electronics through the nation's single largest network of independent stores. Brands Direct have a store close to you with knowledgeable local salespeople. L&B Appliance Sales is the right choice for the discriminating shopper.
The new Hardee's Midnight Moonshine Thick Burger. It's not for everyone. It's not for you if you once tried moonshine, then call the cops on yourself. And if your idea of bootlegging is illegally taping your favorite jam band, it's not for you. But if you like the sweet burn of moonshine glaze on Black Angus beef, it's for you. The Midnight Moonshine Thick Burger. Only at Hardee's.
For a limited time, participating restaurant cooked product contains some alcohol. Midnight Moon is a registered trademark of Piedmont Distillers Incorporated, Madison, North Carolina.
The sun is out, the kids are home, and you're ready to make this summer one they'll never forget. Gather up the family and head over to Lake Winnie, the South's best value amusement park, where there's excitement for everyone. Watch the little ones light up as they experience attractions like the flying elephants and the bumblebees. Get your thrill-seeking hearts racing as you free-fall 14 stories on the Ozone and see if you can stomach the all-new Twister ride. You'll flip over it. Then, satisfy your taste buds with delicious treats like the legendary funnel cakes. With so much to offer and so close to home, Lake Winnie is the perfect place for every family to have fun together. Now open Thursday through Monday. On Thursdays, bring a canned food item and save $5 on an unlimited ride ticket. Sponsored by WRCB-TV. For more information, visit lakewinnie.com.
Hi, everybody. It's Pat Patterson, the racing guy. Don't miss this week's Whoop on Wheels. WOOP-FM 99.9, Fast Eddie, Big G, and Bullet got all your racing news. I'm Pat Patterson. Don't miss it this week.
When you're in the mood for frozen yogurt, come to Cleveland's original, Turkett's, 3506 Keith Street Northwest, located in the same plaza as Gondolier. Turkett's Yogurt. Come see Roger Turpin at Turkett's. 476-1668. Perkett's Yogurt. Often imitated, never duplicated.
Hey, kids, with Pizza Hut's $5 flavor menu, we get any two or more of our favorites for just $5 each.
So, like, medium one-topping pizzas for $5?
Yes.
What about two pizzas and Wing Street Wings?
Yes.
Two pizzas, wings, breadsticks, and a cookie?
Yes.
Okay, no pizzas, 12 Hershey's cookies, still $5 each?
Yes.
Can I join the circus?
Yes. What? No, just eat your pizza.
Feels good to say yes to your Pizza Hut favorites for just $5 each. The $5 flavor menu, only at Pizza Hut.
Limited time offer. Additional charge for extra cheese, toppings, and pan crust. Hershey's trademark used under license.
When Fast Eddie and Big G want to take in a little dirt track racing, it's a good bet they're going to stop in at Quick Burger on South Lee Highway. Quick Burger, Monday through Saturday, 10:30 to 6. Call-in orders are always welcome. That phone number is 472-0463. Stop in and see Ramel Daffron and her crew, Brenda, Rob, Ryan, Ashley, Dawn, and Betty, for the best burger in town. An extensive menu, plate specials, chicken sandwiches, and the best hot dog as well. Check in with Quick Burger on South Lee Highway. When Big G and Fast Eddie need to make a pit stop for lunch, they head to Quiznos. Stop in and see Roger Patel and his crew at Quiznos Sub, 2151 Keith Street. Phone number 473-7976. For all your box lunches and catering needs, stop in and see the folks at Quiznos Sub. Quiznos. Toasty.
Hi, everybody. It's Pat Patterson, the racing guy. If you love your NASCAR, you got to love Whoop on Wheels. Tune in this week, 99.9 FM. Be sure to catch Fast Eddie, Big G, and Bullet. They got it all right there for you.
The sun is out, the kids are home, and you're ready to make this summer one they'll never forget. Gather up the family and head over to Lake Winnie, the South's best value amusement park, where there's excitement for everyone. Watch the little ones light up as they experience attractions like the flying elephants and the bumblebees. Get your thrill-seeking hearts racing as you free-fall 14 stories on the Ozone and see if you can stomach the all-new Twister ride. You'll flip over it. Then, satisfy your taste buds with delicious treats like the legendary funnel cakes. With so much to offer and so close to home, Lake Winnie is the perfect place for every family to have fun together. Now open Thursday through Monday. Every Friday, buy one unlimited ride ticket and receive another for half off with a Dr. Pepper or any Coca-Cola can. For more information, visit lakewinnie.com.
When the Whoop on Wheels crew gets back from a long weekend spent in the infield in Talladega, their first stop in town is Surf's Up Car Wash. Surf's Up, 2575 Guthrie Street Northwest, located next to Cleveland Utilities, 790-5793. Surf's Up Car Wash, voted Cleveland's best 3 years in a row. Stop by and see Mike Royville and his gang at Surf's Up.
The sun is out, the kids are home, and you're ready to make this summer one they'll never forget. Gather up the family and head over to Lake Winnie, the South's best value amusement park, where there's excitement for everyone. Watch the little ones light up as they experience attractions like the flying elephants and the bumblebees. Get your thrill-seeking hearts racing as you free-fall 14 stories on the Ozone and see if you can stomach the all-new Twister ride. You'll flip over it. Then, satisfy your taste buds with delicious treats like the legendary funnel cakes. With so much to offer and so close to home, Lake Winnie is the perfect place for every family to have fun together. Now open Thursday through Monday. Save $3 every day but Saturday with a coupon from Sunbeam Bread. For more information and to discover all the fun-filled attractions Lake Winnie has to offer, visit lakewinnie.com.
Whoop FM is your hometown oasis. WOOP, LP Cleveland.
Whoop, whoop.
Whoop Island, Radio 99. And now, back to Whoop on Wheels.
Whoop on Wheels.
Call 614-5553 to be a part of the show. Only on Whoop Island.
Whoop, whoop.
Radio 99.
All right, we got Mr. Brett Whitehead on there. Brett, how are you doing?
Good. How are you doing, Eddie?
Doing good. You got Fast Eddie here. I mean, Fast Eddie, Big G, and the Bullet in here.
How you doing, Big G?
And Bullet.
All right, Brett.
He didn't hear me.
Bullet?
Hey, Brett, how's it going, my friend?
Good. I'm watching baseball tonight.
I was going to ask you about the Cubs. How's the Cubs doing?
They're winning, by the way, 8-0.
Really?
Over the Cardinals.
Well, that's old Mark Grissom's team.
Yeah.
Mark Grisham?
Yep.
Grissom.
Oh, well, Red always said Grisham. Braves winning?
No, they're tied with the Brewers.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, they're in town starting tonight.
Yeah.
As we get done with the Brewers, Eddie, starting this weekend, starting Saturday, we have the Miami Marlins.
Okay.
Yeah, we have the Miami Marlins starting this weekend.
Well, them Cubs are doing good though.
Yeah, they are.
Me and Brad, we're Braves fans.
Hey, Eddie.
Yeah.
You know who has a birthday starting next week?
Brett Whitehead.
Yep.
How old will you be, Brett?
I'm going to be turning 26.
Oh, you're still a young
boy. Oh, yeah, still youngin'.
Yeah.
Yeah, Brad, how's school's out now, ain't it?
Yep.
You still work over at Bradley?
Yeah. Yeah, we had our last day was Monday.
All right. It's all finals now.
The 24th, the kids have to go pick up their report card.
Yeah.
I used to hate to pick up my report card.
It was all else, wouldn't
it? Yeah. All else.
I know what you mean.
Yeah. I have some scores I need to give you.
All right, let's update.
The Mets are in D.C. playing the Nationals. They're losing. The Nationals are winning 5-1.
Wow.
Over the Mets. They're in first place, by the way.
All right.
No, the Nationals are.
Okay.
They're in first place. The Pirates are winning 6-0 over Arizona.
Woo!
And the New York Yankees are winning 2-0. They're at home with the Blue Jays, and the Phillies are losing to the Tigers 1-0, and the Boston Red Sox are winning 7-2 over the Colorado Rockies. The team I just told you about. The Cubs are winning 8-0 over the Cardinals.
My goodness.
Yeah, the Cubs hot.
And the team I'm looking at right now, it's tied 1-1 in the bottom of the fifth.
How's my old team doing, the Cincinnati Reds, bro?
They don't play till later on in the tonight. They're in
I thought Ricky's calling in.
They're in L.A.
Yeah.
They're in L.A.
Yeah.
They're in L.A. tonight.
I appreciate it, Brett.
They're playing the Dodgers.
And 4, Brett.
Yeah.
Well, that's great. I'm glad to get these scores and updated updates through the Whoop radio here. And Brett Whitehead is our Whoop sports editor here for the Whoop.
And somebody has a birthday next week.
Happy birthday to Brett Whitehead. What day, Brett?
Memorial Day weekend.
Memorial Day weekend. He'll be turned 26. Okay. Happy birthday.
It's Monday.
Oh, yeah, Monday.
The 30th.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, happy birthday to you, Brett.
Hey, Eddie.
Yes.
Don't forget to write me on Facebook, Eddie.
Oh, yeah, that's Monday now. Let me write a note. Well, I can't. My phone's dead.
The 30th.
Okay. The 30th is when I need to do that.
Yeah. After you get off the air, Eddie, don't forget to do that. Put it in your calendar.
Well, I can't.
No. After you get your phone
charged. Yeah.
All right.
That sounds good. I'll do it.
All right, man.
See you, Brett.
All right, too.
All right, bye.
Birthday boy.
Birthday boy for Brett Whitehead, the 30th next Tuesday night. We can wish him a happy birthday on the Wolf on Wheels show.
That's it.
He lives in a man cave.
Let me write a note there. Whoa! Let me write a note there, Big G, about Mr. Whitehead's birthday next week.
I still ain't gave him nothing. It's been 4 years since his birthday, and he don't ever let me give it nothing.
Well, he wanted you.
I supposed to make it work at Cleveland High School, and that's the reason he won't come to Cleveland High School.
Oh.
Yeah, he's a Bradley fan. I said, well, when they play Cleveland, let me give you something for your birthday.
I'm neither one.
you're actually Polk County, aren't you?
No, I ain't neither one.
I've been a Cleveland fan for...
I'm a McMahon fan.
Well, McMahon's all right. I've been a Cleveland fan for about 45 years.
45 years.
Yeah, I've been a Cleveland fan. I've been going there 40. Hadn't missed a game 40 years.
Next week, we're going to have some kind of a show here. I'm going to get on it. Got to get on it heavy, boys, I do, for next week. Well, until next week, we're going to close it out here.
Yep. Say good night.
Yeah, I don't know what happened to Johnny Roberts, but we're going to close out. God bless the USA and the troops. And we'll talk to you next week.
Good night.
Good night.
You've arrived. Wolf Island is your hometown oasis. WOOP, LP Cleveland. Whoop, whoop. Wolf Island, Radio 99.
Checking cash.
Need a little extra cash right away? Who doesn't? Turn your car into cash at Check Into Cash.
Get up to $4,000 with your car title only from Check Into Cash. You get more cash with a Check Into Cash title line of credit.
Turn your car into cash today at Check Into Cash. Visit checkintocash.com for the store near you.
$4,000 title line of credit maximum based on value of vehicle and ability to repay. Subject to credit approval. See store for details.
Did you know that U.S. Money Shops cashes all checks, even the ones most check cashers reject? Tax refund checks, government checks, payroll checks, and many more. And when you cash a check with U.S. Money Shops, we'll give you 10% off your next purchase. At U.S. Money Shops, we have everything you need at a fraction of regular retail. So stop by one of our 11 locations or visit us online at usmoneyshops.com.
Buy or sell or find today the better way at U.S.